Hi, my name's Steve, and I'm the head of front-end engineering at Temporal, and this is a course on becoming a Visual Studio Code power user. The faster you are with your tools, the more they get out of your way. In this course, you'll learn how to focus on the parts of your code that matter. In this course, we'll cover how to navigate around the editor itself, as well as across your code base to find just the piece of code you're looking for. We'll look at how to do large-scale refactors quickly and safely with ease. We'll also cover creating tasks to do everything from spinning up a simple web server to running complicated workflows. We'll explore how to use the debugger to step through your code line by line with access to everything along the way. And finally, we'll take a look at how to begin to build your own extensions for VS Code so you can extend the editor in the ways that best serve you. Get ready to use Visual Studio Code like a pro and build apps even faster.
The other really powerful thing at VS Code that I use honestly every day, all the time, too often, is multiple cursors, right? Multiple cursors does what you think it does. There's a bunch of ways to use multiple cursors. One is hold down the Option or Alt key and start clicking. Now, I have multiple cursors. You will learn something very quickly, though. Your aim is terrible. Right? So what do you do when your aim is terrible? So let's say I was hitting Alt, and the nice part about my font being gigantic right now is my aim is great. But on a normal font size, on a normal size monitor, like with a trackball, my aim is terrible. So let's say we start with one here, I put another one, and then whoops, I missed the at symbol. All right, so Command, or I think Control U, will remove the last one, right? That's good, that's great. But ultimately, you're never going to click on all the things that you want, right? So let's say, hypothetically, I wanted to take all of these function declarations and I wanted to turn them into arrow functions, right? I could do this. Now you can find the next one. I'm not doing this. Like, I can't live like this. The other option is you can select something, right? In this case, export, but let's say export function, and then hit Command D, and it'll grab the next one. And you can hit Command D again, and it'll grab the next one. You do that enough, and you can see it actually filled out the search thing, which we'll see in a second. And now I've got all of the export functions selected with multiple cursors. Now, I can do something like this. You'll notice that I've done this before. Const, there we got it. And if we scroll down, my multiple cursors all worked on their given line, and I just changed all of these function declarations into arrow functions. Useful, like a lot of times when you're cleaning up text, right? Or like trying to find all your console logs, right? So to delete them, right? Could you have gotten really fancy with a regex in the search and replace? Yes, you could have. Are you going to? No, it's better, it's easier to find one console log and slam on Command D until you have all of them and like select the line and delete it. So that will work. The other thing that you can do that you will know it when you need it is, this is one of the things where I have to like, I've done from muscle memory so many times, I gotta think about it, is, so on a Mac it's Command, Option, Arrow. You can just like start putting cursors up and down, right? And grab them. That's like nice if you've got a bunch of stuff in a like given like CSV or something along those lines. The other one that you can do, and I actually made this its own like page in the notes because it was like, this was like a month ago when I was like gonna like lose it, which is export const, and let's give it some kind of like regex in this case. We'll say like, if you hit hold Option or Alt and hit Enter, you will get multiple cursors on everything that matches the regex, right? So you don't even have to have the exact word. You can have like roughly a pattern. If you hold Option or Alt while you hit Enter, you will now get multiple cursors on everything that matches that regex, which is useful. Like, let's say some of these had like three arguments and I wanted to still like match the entire line. I could get fancy with the regex and I could do it. Debugging, like, so we got test.json and we have this other idea of launch.json. The launch.json will start up your app and hook it up to some kind of debugger, right? What kind of debugger? It depends on what kind of debugging you want to do. You can debug Node apps. You can debug Python apps. You can get extensions. Like, we at Temporal have one that will actually let you stop and debug an actual Temporal workflow in our TypeScript SDK, right? So like, there are custom debuggers that can be written as well, but the built-in ones are Node, Chrome, Edge. I'm sure I wrote a list somewhere, a few other ones. So you can hit run debug. You can also hit this create launch.json file. Create a launch, let's do the Node one. I think I want to launch. Don't want to look at my own notes. Source, and I think it's server.js. We can hit launch program, which is going to launch server.js. I don't want to walk through anything in Node internals, please. And the type is Node. We can also add more configurations if you also wanted to, like, you know, attach to an Electron main process. Again, a lot of these are like super good for Electron, actually, because there's just a lot of things to hook into. You can attach to a currently running process as well. So on and so forth. But now if you hit F5, so now you can see I've got the server running over here, right? Nothing yet to see in here. And I will also start up my client. So we can go over to the client real quick. We've got a task manager. Yeah, you thought you were gonna get out of workshop without a to-do list? Absolutely not. No, this is front-end masters. We put to-do lists. So now I've got just the front end running just so I can not write curl requests. And I've got the server running on 3000. So let's just verify that, task, buy croutons from store. Great. Went into a database. Life is good. So now what I can do is if I go into server.js, I've got this wonderful, amazing Express app. And so we can do lots of things. We could say, I can get a task by ID. That's not in the app. We can post. I like this. We can go anywhere we want. And we can add a little breakpoint. Right? And now what we can do is go ahead and use our app again. Read a book. Books are good. And I didn't even command tab, right? I got sent back into VS Code, and we can see, I can type in title, and there is the title that passed in. I can see the full like call stack of Express's router and the middleware for next, so on and so forth, right? I can, you know, I have that breakpoint in there, and so it stopped me there. I have access to all of the variables if I was so inclined. So I could actually say title equals play video games, right? And now I've changed that variable. And I've got these controls up here, which again are continue, which is go past the breakpoint, like step over it into a given function, out, so on and so forth. I'm gonna be honest with you, a lot of times I just want to change something, hit play, I want to see what that value is. It's like, where did undefined come from? Sometimes I will step up through the stack if I'm like, I'm getting tired of putting console logs everywhere, because let's be honest, we all know how we really debug. So now I can go ahead and hit play. And then obviously we changed the value before it went into the database, and here it is. right? And so if I wanted to see like, okay, what are all the things on, you know, the request object at this point or the response, like I have access to everything that is currently in memory at that moment of time. I've frozen the world, right? I can like evaluate almost anything that I would ever possibly want to do. And then I can like carry on along my merry way. So let's try it again. And we can say, I'm running out of things. Read a book. All right, and now, for instance, if we wanted to go up a level, you can see that we are somewhere in the express land of a layer with some kind of like handle request middleware. And I can kind of like step through, like a little more helpful if I had more than one function or I put the breakpoint somewhere else. But the fact of the matter is, oh, this thing was already undefined by that point. Go up a function, go up. And you, instead of like, cause even here, I'm not putting console logs in here. Like I can put console logs in my code. I'm not going into node modules and hand editing some compiled code. That ain't happening. But at any given point, right, I can look at, I'm assuming, I can see that the request object in this point and like work with it as well, right? And again, then I can move forward. Through my application as well, and see everything along. Let's talk about building extensions. We have seen extensions can be everything. I mean, the dev container stuff is an extension. Just the ability to regex ES build errors is an extension that just provides a problem matcher. Some pretty little icons are an extension. This theme is an extension. That AI toolkit that I said that was like a full-on app that is like better than a lot of the, like, there are other Electron apps. The AI toolkit built into VS Code is good, right? Like, do you want to look at a PDF if I happen to click on one? Because I work on the website sometimes and like terms of service and stuff like that. Like, all of those things, this ability for the ChatGPT Mac OS app to hook into VS Code is an extension, right? So an extension could be everywhere from a theme all the way up to like an embedded app experience. Like you could build, again, like, you know those, like, there's like 1,000 of these apps that like let you like open a MySQL database and see the tables. You could absolutely build that inside of VS Code, right? And just like, you know, if I click on a SQLite file, give me a UI, because it's, again, like there's no SQLite libraries. I'm using them in these applications. You could, you know, or for whatever you need to do. Again, I work on a developer tool. So like we are working on building one for just using our own developer tool and all the integrations of like, hey, spin up the server, spin it down, jump into the web UI to debug, start a workflow, stop a workflow, off, you know, those are all things you can do. And so we'll take a look at a bunch of different options. Now, if you want to set up the boilerplate, I guess, could you do it by hand? You could do it by hand. Should you do it by hand? Probably not. So let's talk about scaffolding an extension, which is, gonna grab two things, which is Yaoman, which is the CLI command is yo. And Yaoman uses generators to generate projects. And this point, code, not just generating code, but like VS Code, right? And so far that like even, it's Visual Studio Code, but like, you know. So this is the Yaoman generator for VS Code extensions, right? You run this, you have the ability to go, yo, code, which I've been waiting, honestly, for like multiple hours to say. So, awesome. So I also have some boilerplates in that repo ready to go that you can take a look at, but for funsies, we're gonna run it ourselves. So I'm just in that main directory, yo code. Cool. And you can see all of the different kinds of extensions that you can build. We'll talk about them. New extension is kind of like world's your oyster, right? Like you can go anywhere from building that AI toolkit to like VS Code pets, right? Yes, I will remind you, VS Code Pets still exists. It has not gone away in the last 3 hours. That is a VS Code extension that we all deserve. You can do that in either TypeScript or JavaScript. What's the difference? One has a compile step. I had at one point check, which is, I believe that they are still common JS because Electron did not support ES modules forever and ever and ever and ever, and VS Code is an Electron app. So there is a compile step here, so on and so forth. So I already made a color theme extension that's in there, but yeah, you can generate one. You will see some boilerplate. I have a few ready to go, but like other than run this generator and put in the pieces of code that have nothing to do with Visual Studio Code, like the ones I have in the repo are the same thing. So let's go ahead and we'll do that instead. But that's, you know, like, so I've got a few, we've got regular expressionists, we've got very cool colors, we're gonna start there, and we're gonna take a look at it. And we're gonna open it up in code. That font is so big. How did I end up with this Amazon Q thing? I was talking, I said yes. I regret everything. I'll uninstall it later. I don't even know what it is. Cool. So in this case, this is again the output of the generator for a VS Code extension, which really in this point, like if we look at the package.json, the one of the major things in any VS Code extension is what does it contribute? Right, if it is commands, like we saw that we can like always assign key bindings to a given command where it would have been like workbench.actions or you know github.whatever, temporal.whatever, so on and so forth. You can contribute settings, you can anything that, like what are the ways in which you are extending VS Code with this plugin that goes in your package.json as a manifest, right? So in this case, we are just contributing a theme, which I have called Very Cool Colors, which is a dark theme. And it is available in /themes, Very Cool Colors, -color theme.json, right? Other tasty notes here is we can see that there is a launch.json, which is using a type we haven't seen before called extension host. This basically gives you the ability to launch the extension in a little fake, real separate version of VS Code and play around with it, right? And so if we think about this extension, this is our very simple start here, where effectively we got a package JSON, we got a theme JSON, we got a lot of JSON in here. We don't have anything but JSON. We got a VS Code ignore, which is like, what are the parts that are not part of the extension? It's very similar to like an NPM ignore, or arguably a Git ignore, which is like, which are the parts we don't need to publish to NPM, which are the parts that should not be bundled in the extension, so on and so forth. But yeah, we effectively just got JSON files. So I can hit F5, and you can see I get a more different version of VS Code. What is fundamentally different about this VS Code? The theme. Why? Because this is the rando theme that I made. I don't know, it's a theme. This Amazon Q is still here. Yeah, is it a good looking theme? No. Did I just pick random colors? 100%. Do I kind of like it? Like, it's a little retro and I'm kind of into it. It's kind of growing on me.